Welcome to the Parish Church of St. Luke online for this, the 19th Sunday after the Pentecost. As we come before God this day, we offer prayer to center ourselves. Let us pray. God of love and mercy, give us clean hands and pure hearts that we may walk in innocence and come to your eternal dwelling to praise you in the company of your saints forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, to God, in the holiness, and the peace, please, for all the world.
Glory to God in the holiness.
let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone. Join us together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may become a holy temple, acceptable to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Job. There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. One day, the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him for no reason." Then Satan answered the Lord, "Skin for skin. All that people have, they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he is in your power. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd with which to scrape himself and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of the Hebrews. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels, but someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Mark. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" And he answered them, "What did Moses command you?" And they said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. And for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. And he said to them, "Whosoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The Gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May only the truth be spoken here, and may only the truth be received here. This we pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus said, "Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter into it." The kingdom of God is a gift. We receive it. We do not take it. It is not something that we can take away or remove. It's nothing that something you can storm to get into. We need to be open in order to receive the gifts of the kingdom of God and to receive each other into the kingdom. My dear sensei taught us the way of the open hand in karate. He asked a simple question. When you make a fist, what can you receive? Nothing. Only when our hands are open can we receive. An open hand is a gesture of friendship and welcome. An open hand is ready to receive. How can we receive the kingdom of God if our hands and our hearts are not open, if our minds are not open, if our spirit is not open to the other? The gospel reading for today is one of the hard sayings of Jesus. We might ask ourselves, why are we still reading this? Things have changed in 2,000 years. Yes. Sometimes the loving thing to do is to part ways, especially in a situation where the relationship is broken beyond repair. That's not for me to judge. But why is this still read in church? It's a legitimate question, because sometimes texts like this reading for today from Mark have been misused and misinterpreted over the years. The point of these readings is not to make people feel guilty, it's not to make people feel ashamed. There's a larger purpose that Jesus has in this difficult teaching. The topic for this reading is the kingdom of God. It's not just about divorce. People suffer because relationships sometimes break down. We're made for perfect relationships, and none of our relationships are perfect. So the theme is the kingdom of God and how we struggle to live our messy lives, and what wisdom does Jesus have to help us live through our difficulties and our challenges. Context for us is, you know, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission completed its work 6 years ago. We had a day to celebrate that on Thursday, but the hard work toward genuine reconciliation will take generations. We have much to learn. Our redemption is tied to our Indigenous brothers and sisters. When one person suffers, we all suffer. I need to learn, we need to learn what it means to be in genuine, loving relationships with others. What does the gospel for today have to teach us? Well, if you look at where St. Mark places this teaching, it's in a larger section of teachings on the kingdom and how we care for and treat people who are vulnerable, like how we didn't treat the children in the residential schools. So enter stage left, the Pharisees. And we hear their question to test Jesus. They ask, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Jesus turns the question back on them, asking them, what does it say in the law? What did Moses write there? And they answered that Moses did indeed allow us to draw up a writ of dismissal in case of divorce. Jesus says that it was because you were so hard-hearted that Moses wrote this commandment for you. Hard-hearted. What does it mean to be hard-hearted? Some expressions come to mind, like a heart of stone, unfeeling, cold, unsympathetic, intolerant, and uncharitable. Hard-hearted is closed off and unloving, unbalanced. There can be no mutuality in a relationship with one party has a closed and hard heart. But let's contrast this with the creation stories In the Genesis story of the creation of humankind, creation is in relationship, light and darkness, earth and water and sky, the lights of the night, the lights of the day, all the animals and all the plants. We're in relationship with creation. It's a beautiful and wondrous communion, a complex of interrelated and multifaceted organic and inorganic systems, what we call ecosystems. All creation and all things are pronounced good as they are in relationship. Adam is formed of the dust, literally an earthling, and he is alone. And it's not good for the man to be alone. And it's not until the creation of Eve, the two become one, that the creation process for humanity is complete. This is a relationship of reciprocity and mutuality. And so where Eve is referred to as a helper, this is not a subservient position. In the scriptures, God is often referred to as our helper. Each person has their gifts, their strengths, and abilities to bring to the partnership, into the relationship. Jesus' teaching says a great deal about what it means to be human and how we care for each other. We're made for relationships of love and caring. In the first century, women had few rights and did not have the same rights as women do now in our North American context. If a woman was divorced by her husband, unless her family would take her in, she would very likely become destitute. Jesus' teaching is therefore about justice. It is unjust and uncaring to simply dismiss your wife and leave her totally vulnerable. Hard-heartedness leads to broken relationships and suffering. There are many ways to understand love. Love is not simply romantic love or erotic love or the kind of love that is between a parent and a child or between siblings or between friends. Yes, these are wonderful expressions of love, but in today's reading, Jesus is pointing to a kind of love which transcends even these. The New Testament word agape sometimes is translated as love, and it's often translated as charity. Not charity in the sense of modern charities, although it's about giving, but this love is a reflection of God's love for us, lived out in selfless and compassionate ways. This is the kind of love I think Jesus is pointing to for us. And ultimately, this kind of love involves choice. And in our Christian context, marriage is not just a commitment, it is a meta-commitment. It's a commitment to the commitment. In our marriage ceremony, the family gives their blessing to the marriage. And the gathered community promises to do all in our power to support and uphold the marriage. We need to live that out a heck of a lot better. And only after this does the couple enter into this beautiful covenant and unite themselves to each other in love. Now, I've presided at countless weddings, and it's a great privilege and it's a great honor. Because during the promises and the vows, the couple's eyes are shining and their hearts are open and overflowing with love. And if you're close to the couple, you can see it in their eyes, you can see it in their body language, that they're open and receptive to each other. In fact, they give themselves to each other in love. The couple is living out the values of the kingdom of heaven. Being receptive to the kingdom, being receptive like a little child. Jesus says, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. The kingdom of God is a gift. And we need to be open in order to receive the kingdom of God, receive each other. We receive it when we give ourselves to others in acts of compassionate, loving kindness. Amen. Amen.
Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, Lord. We pray knowing that we meet and work in Treaty One land, the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Cree, and Dakota people, and the homeland of the Métis Nation. We are grateful for their stewardship of this land and their hospitality, which allows us to live, work, and serve God, the Creator, here. Creator God, we thank you for the gift of prayer. We greet you in the quiet of this morning. May we be made anew, joining your presence in each other. Assist us to seek your direction moment by moment. We pray, saying, Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. Creator God, we are grateful for the brightness and continued warmth of our September and October days. The brightness lifts our spirits, and the last remaining blooms, the wind and the falling of colored leaves, are continuous offerings. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. Teacher of our souls, we bow before you, and we are grateful for the effort of many in our parish. We count as blessings the energy of the schola, the church staff, Fathers Paul and Dwight, and for Blair's many hats. Bless our parish members. Bless them individually and corporately in this unruly time of COVID. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. God of principalities and powers, our governments appear to be hovering over us often. Canada's provincial governments have determined the boundaries and restrictions of COVID-19. Some have handled it well, and some not so well. A national election, often critiqued, has just passed. As Manitobans waiting for a new premier, keep us patient and generous in mind and heart. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. Eternal One, you alone are God, holy and most high. Like Job, school us in the ways of faith and wisdom. May we learn to truly see and hear, and in humility find blessing. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. O God of health and healing, we come to you amidst a fourth wave of COVID-19. We pray for citizens in provinces west of Manitoba. Pandemic numbers there are escalating beyond safe and controllable boundaries. We ask for your care and compassion for patients and frontline workers. We pray also for staff being flown in to assist in these crises. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. God of quiet and petition, hear us individually, Lord. We pray silently, naming our petitions, our fears, and our thanksgivings. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. God of health and disease, we pray for peace and comfort and courage for all who are troubled in mind, body, or spirit. This morning we pray especially for our parishioners on the prayer list and those who are grieving. We pray for cherished ones who are seriously ill and quite possibly dying. May each of them know your singular sense of wholeness. Spirit of grace and kindness, hear our prayer. Sovereign God, you make us for each other to live in caring community. Teach us to choose love that is committed and devoted. Teach us, like little children, to wonder and to trust that our loving may reflect the image of Christ. These prayers we offer in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of truth, receive all we offer you this day. Make us worthy servants, strong to follow in the pattern of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death and banish the darkness of sin and despair. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, he took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you do this, you do it in memory of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your church. Gather into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, let us pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of our Jesus. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We in Him are one body, for we all share in the one bread.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may we who have been strengthened by this Eucharist remain in your steadfast love and show in our lives the saving mystery that we celebrate. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Glory to God.
Whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.